So the topic for today is Saint Joseph, pillar of family life. So let us start in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Father, we thank you and we give you praise for your goodness to us. We thank you for our lives. We thank you, Father, for good health. We thank you for the privilege of being your children and for the opportunity you have given us this evening to gather and hear your word, even in the midst of this pandemic. We pray, Lord, that you send down your Holy Spirit upon our facilitator, Father Teko. We pray that his words may be filled with your power to transform the lives of those of us listening to him this evening. And we also pray for ourselves, O Lord, that your Holy Spirit may open our minds and soften our hearts and strengthen our wills so that whatever we hear today will bear good fruit. For all this we ask in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. So before we start, just a few observations. As usual, we are all to keep our mics muted and our videos off to increase the bandwidth. And any questions that you want to ask, we should type them in the chat box. So if any question comes to us as the class is going on, we type them in the chat box. And at the end of the class, Father, we take some time, a few minutes, to answer as many of the questions as time allows. So this is so that we can have an uninterrupted flow during the talk. All right. So thank you very much, Father. Once again, we'll hand over to you now. You can go ahead with the talk. Thank you.
I hope you can all hear me. Can you all hear me?
Okay. Yes, we can hear you. It's not the song.
Now we can hear you.
Oh, you couldn't hear the song? Oh, sorry. I'm so sorry.
No, it's okay.
All right. Oh, I thought you were hearing the song. Oh, well, so sorry for that. Okay, so let's just move on. So this is the quotation for the day. Quotation of the day. You can, when God wishes to raise a soul to greater height, he united to Saint Joseph by giving it a strong love for the good saint, said by that priest out there, that saint. Thank you once again. As I said, we thank God today and we thank all of you for your understanding and for once again accepting me to lead you through the Lenten recollection this year. So let's just go briefly to the overview. And so we'll go to why the year of Saint Joseph. As we all know, we are in the year of Saint Joseph. So why that? Then after that, we will look at some of the biblical texts. You look at Saint Joseph, you realize that you don't hear anything about him talking. So we need some of the text, and then some of the third one will be the cultural background and biblical interpretation. And to understand who Saint Joseph is, it is then that we'll be able to know, see him as a pillar of a family life. So, and then implication to our life. So basically we'll be using 35 minutes. So I'm conscious of the time. So let's go. So why the year of Saint Joseph? We all know we are in the year of Saint Joseph, declared the Holy Father. One of the reasons, you know, the first reason is that to celebrate. We're celebrating 150 years of Saint Joseph as a patron of the church. So that is it. And so the Holy Father came out with encyclical. You can read the Father's Heart. So that is it. And also, it is 150 years since he had been declared a patron of the saint by this the Pope Pius IX. You know, he declared Saint Joseph as a patron of the Catholic Church. Is also to reset or reflect on fatherhood, because you realize that the whole concept of fatherhood is in jeopardy as we talk now, especially in the world. So it is up to us now this time to reflect on fatherhood. Someone said something that actually touched me, and this is what the person said. You know, he said, I never had a father, so I had no idea what a father is. So hard to think of God as a father when I have no idea about what a father. So when you realize that it's just summary of what is happening in the world now. So a failed, wounded fatherhood as we have it in our world today. And this one also said, you know, we need something like this. My father said it himself in an interview many years ago, husband and wife failed, but mother and father didn't. I have got a life that really matters to me. And that's because of the way I was raised. My ethics are high because my parents did a great job. So you see, and you look at also in the world today where we have jobless fathers, parents, unemployment high, rate of unemployment, our youth are unemployed, some fathers have no job, so very difficult to take care of their families. We a world where we have broken homes all over, we have same-sex marriage looming, you know, and where we have pornography at its ascendancy. You look at the countries, you know, just going so high, pornography, and this is leading to infidelity, this is leading to fall of divorce, and every year you see 52% of all marriages today end in divorce. So sad. And so that is it. We have rape all over, domestic violence. Also, you come to the church where we call the priest father, father, father. You see the scandals, the church scandal all over, all because of what we call a failed, wounded fatherhood. So that is what is happening now. So this is the time for us to actually reflect on fatherhood. Saint Joseph as a father, we reflect on him, and we see ourselves, especially men, for that matter, and they use him as our model. And as some 11 verse 3 says, you know, if a foundations are destroyed, what can the judge do? So foundation one destroyed, what can the judge do? So when we have a failed structure, the basis, and then Pope John Paul II will say, where family goes, there goes the world. So we have that basic structure, which is going down and down, down, down. You realize that it's going to affect every fabric in society. And it is a war settled so many years ago by this lovely lady. You see, you can see it there. After that, you have it. He said, the final battle between the Lord and Satan is going to be about what? Marriage and family life. And we can see the battle already. We see where family life and married life is going down and down. And when that happens, what do we do as a church? And it has been prophesied long ago by this priest in 19th century. He said the church in the future will be going through a difficult time. But when the church turns to Saint Joseph and acknowledges his dignity, role, and importance, she will experience a tremendous victory over darkness. And so it has been said so many years ago by this priest, Father Isidore de Isolanis, so many years ago. And so I think the Holy Father is just going according to that, especially now that we have a failed fatherhood, when we have single parents and fathers are not ready to take responsibility of their actions. And so we are in a year of Saint Joseph. And as I said, we need some biblical passages to be able to understand who Saint Joseph actually is. And when you go to the Bible, first of all, you look at John chapter 1, you see Jesus' disciple will not talk about Joseph. So they will be saying, mentioning his name in relation to Jesus. And Philip found Nathanael and said to him, we have found him about whom Moses and the law and also the prophet wrote, Jesus, son of Joseph from Nazareth. So you see, not Joseph per se, but it's in relation to Jesus. And also the crowd, what they also said something in relation to Joseph, talking about Jesus. So they were saying, is this not Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and Mary we know? So you see, again, in John chapter 6, verse 42, in relation to Jesus. And then we come to the Gospel of St. Luke, you know, Gospel according to St. Luke. Also, this is where it is a little bit, they gave us some information about it, not in relation to Mary or Jesus or anybody. But then himself, Joseph also went from, so he traveled from Nazareth to Bethlehem, you know, Luke chapter 2, verse. So Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. So also mentioned in relation to marriage. So you go to Luke chapter 1 verse. So to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David, a virgin. That his name was Mary. So you see, so always in relation. So also here, Saint Luke in relation again and again and again and again. So and then when you come to that of Matthew, trying to link Jesus to Joseph, linking Jesus to Joseph. His reason is a little bit theological in the sense that he was trying to tell us that Jesus the historical Jesus, as we call him, historical Jesus, you know, was fully human and fully divine. And so the Son of God still needed a human father because he was also truly human, exposed to threats which demanded a parental care. So Matthew chapter 1. That was the reason why he put in there. So if you go to the beginning, this one is the father of these, this one is the father, the genealogy, you get it there. Then we come to the culture. We get to know something, a little bit of that. Then we'll be able to understand who Joseph actually, you know, was and it still is to us today. And so the Roman Catholic Church teaches that Mary was ever virgin, that we know, but that her perpetual virginity does not mean that she and Joseph were not really married. They were married. And so let's get into a little bit of the culture. When it comes to the among the Jews, we have, when it comes to the process of marriage as we have it, you know, for them they have two divided. We can see it, the division into two. We have a betrothal and a consummation. The betrothal could also be seen as the engagement, you know. And according to the Jewish culture, when we're talking about engagement, it lasts for 1 year, you know, in exception of widows. So it was during this period, you know, during this, and then when they are engaged, as when the man is engaged to the woman, within that one period, you know, they will not meet as we do it now. Then you see the man will start seeing the woman before even we're talking about all that. No, for them, the man, you will see the woman from afar, but you not come together to do anything like a married couple. So that is within this period. Then the angel came to Mary, then announced to her that she will give birth to a child, and then the name will be Jesus and all of that. So within this period, and then there, after that, Mary decided to go to visit Elizabeth, you know, in a city called Enkarim, you know. So that is where the whole thing happened. Then she came back and she was almost already 3 months pregnant. So how would she explain this to Joseph? And so it became very difficult. And after explaining to Joseph about the whole a saga about the pregnancy, you realize that Joseph decided to make this bold decision. He said, so then the husband, then Joseph, her husband, being a just man and not wanting to make her public example, you know, was minded to put her away secretly. So he wanted to do divorce, to go with a divorce secretly. And then why secretly? Why secretly? So we have a lot of theories about that. The first one is, we call it a respect theory. There's a mistake there. He doesn't want to disrespect Mary. So he wanted to do it secretly. And the second one is that we call it innocence theory. He doesn't really believe she committed. So when Mary explained to Joseph, Joseph actually understood Mary and he didn't want to disgrace her. And so he wanted to, and then people also to start talking that are within just a 1 month or within 2 weeks, within a few days, you got married. And then here you are, your wife is pregnant, and people start talking what actually happened. And so he wanted to do that secretly. We have other theories, but this is not the time. We don't have the time to explore other theories. And one thing we should also note is that you realize, but then you see that what is the law saying? What did he supposed to do actually? If he wanted to go by the law, this is what will happen. The law is clear on that. Deuteronomy chapter 24, verse 1 to 2. He says that if a man takes a wife and realizes that he is having a questionable uncleanness in her, he has every right to file for divorce. You know, he has every right to file for a divorce. that is what the law actually said about that. But, and so Joseph would have gone straight to file for a divorce, you know, but he didn't want to disgrace Mary. He also believed in her innocence. That is why he didn't go through that. So the law is clear. You see, what would have happened when Joseph, you know, decided to go this way, you know, that would have led to a lot of stuff. One, you realize that Mary would have been, they would have stoned her to death, because it is clear here, you know, if you read that, you realize that even in John chapter 8, verse 2 to 11, when that woman committed adultery, they came to Jesus asking him, you know, wanting his seal. And Jesus said, one without sin should cut the first stone. So this is what would have happened to Mary. Mary would have been stoned to, brought outside the gate of the town, and then stoned to death. Or Mary, in that case, even if it happened that way, that she has no one to marry her, she would have turned into a prostitute. Just like if you follow the genealogy of Jesus, you realize that most of the women were prostitutes. Mary would have been one of them. But because Joseph decided to take this responsibility, that is why the fate of Mary was sealed. That's why that did not happen to her, you know. And so right after Joseph was thinking of running away from Mary, you know, the angel came and told Joseph that, okay, please take the woman back home. Let us now look at Joseph for that matter. After we have delved into some of the historical background and cultural background and what the Bible said, now let us just take a look at the personality Joseph, because that is, so we say Joseph, the pillar of family life. And when we come into, this is from the litany of St. Joseph. This is from the litany of St. Joseph. When you look at the litany, you see a pillar of family life. Pray for us. This is the litany of St. Joseph. Now, one of the things written about Joseph is that he is a pillar of family life. Let's take a look at the world today and compare it to the time of Joseph. If it were to be useful to be in our time today, do you think full of, this is the family of today, abuse, neglect, addiction, and crime, impatient, depression, disaster, divorce. You think Joseph will remarry, retirement, and all of that. We have all in our families today. And do you think Joseph would have taken such a responsibility if Joseph happened to be in our time? The answer is going to be no. It's going to be no. And one thing we can learn about Joseph is that he happened to be, if you look at his life carefully, he happened to be a man of prayer. He protected his family through prayer. You see, this is where the whole thing turned. And prayer, when we talk about prayer, it's not always talking. It's about being in relationship with God. And we be that relationship, you know, being that communion with God, you realize that Joseph was always contemplating a man of prayer. It is through this that the angel revealed to him through contemplation. When he was thinking about it, he realized that he tried to meditate upon it, he tried to descend, and then the angel spoke to him and told him, hey, Joseph, you know, son of David, do not be afraid to take to you Mary, your wife. And so, very deep-seated, you know, personality, man of prayer, and that is what we need at our time. And do we have that in our families today? No, we don't have it. We don't pray with that. We don't teach them to pray. Our fathers, for that matter, some people don't even go to church. It's only the women that go to church. And this is the character we need. If you want to be a protector of your family, if you want to be a pillar of your family, you have to be a man of prayer. But we see that always now, especially in our time, where we see only women go to church and then men sit home. They don't come to church. And that is what we're talking about. And this is Moses. And through listening to God, you know, through that, he was able to carry out the mission. You know, he happened to be an ambassador of God, and listening to God, he was able to carry out many, 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 many missions. Well, you know, as the head of the family, the woman is the heart, the man, the head. So he was able to carry out his mission. And then God would be able to tell him, take the child to Egypt. He would do that, always in that relationship, in that communion with God. And without that in our families, we're going to fail. If you don't pray, No, where do you get those virtues, those values from, Christian values? So you fail if you don't pray. And this is the man of prayer, always listening to God and carry out his mission. You know, he is not going to say that, no, I am going to carry on the head of the family and then think without consulting God. He always consults God. And this is the man with a very strong personality, very strong, firm person. And most men, most of us men today, we are not strong at all. We are not. And then silence. You look at the test, you realize that throughout, Joseph was silent. You will not hear him talking. Silence, you know, in silence, he carry out his duty, you know, and that is what we need. Some of us, we talk, nakedness. That is not Joseph, you know, a model for manhood, for husband and fathers. And then patient, very patient with Mary, you know, very patient. And that is what we need in our families. We need to be patient. And then responsible. Most of us are not responsible. When anytime something happens within us and our wives and then us, we realize that we are found wanted. This is what we need to do. And sometimes we are not ready to carry out some responsibilities as fathers. And it's happening not only, it's all over the world. You realize that is lacking in most of us who call ourselves fathers. That is actually one of our weak points, not ready to carry out responsibilities. You know, we talk about freedom, but when it comes to the responsibility, we are not. Always his action is louder than his words. You know, you will not hear him utter with that man of action, carrying out his role, his duty as a man, as the husband of the family, of the holy family. And that is what we are talking about. And then obedient to God, as usual, when God asked him, send Mary to your home, she did exactly that, obedient to God and faithful to why didn't cheat. And Mary didn't. He supported Mary. And this has an protective instinct. He would have exposed Mary to the dangers of at a time. He should have been stoned, she would have become a prostitute, but he decided to shield the wife. And that is what was so lacking. Most men are not ready to shield their wives. When something happens, you see them telling their friends, my wife did this, go and tell their mothers, my wife did this, not able to shield them, you know, not ready to protect them. And Joseph did exactly that, protected Mary, protected Jesus, you know. That is what we need, you know. And through that, when we know that as a father, you protect your family, the children will also be bold, you know, will develop that qualities, you know. And that is what we actually mean. You know, Joseph, you know, is a vigilant and a man of discernment and action, as we said, always discern before carrying out, you know, his any action. He descends, consults God, he sees himself as ambassador, an instrument. Is that the case in our families? No. When we want to do something, we don't come together, pray together, and then seek for God's intervention before we carry out our missions, you know. And that is, Joseph didn't do that. That was why he was able to survive a storm. And this is one thing. And then if you want to know more about Joseph, just look at the life of Jesus, a prayerful man. He learned from home. If you want to know a man, you know, if I want to know a lot more about your home, I just look at your children. When they come to church, when I give them something, when they say thank you, I know you are doing your work as a parent because you teach them how to say thank you. When they are well-versed in the Bible, you see Jesus in the temple, well-versed, teaching even elders. You see, Joseph, he taught him how to read the Bible. So if you see all those qualities in Jesus, it's just this because Joseph did his work as a father. He played his role perfectly. And so that is what is lacking in families today. And these are a few things we can also internalize. And if you look at the life of Joseph, one is to accept life as it is, with all its contradiction, frustration, and disappointment. That is what he accepted life as it is, with all the contradiction. Did he understand certain things? He said, do this, and then there he goes. You will do it. And that is what sometimes you have to do. Just accept life as it is with all contradictions. And then two, one thing we learn, you know, we can learn about Joseph is that through him, God is telling us not to be afraid, because faith gives meaning to every event. Don't be afraid, because faith gives meaning to every event, however happy or sad it may seem to be. He makes us aware that Joseph makes us aware that God can make flowers spring up from stony ground. That's one thing. And then the last one is that don't look for shortcuts. You know, Joseph didn't look for shortcuts, like run away from Mary. You know, after he heard the voice of God, he didn't run away from those responsibilities. Confront reality with open eyes and accept personal responsibility for it. And that is what we have to do if we want to thrive, if we want to reset the button of fatherhood, especially indeed when the church declares this year to be a year of St. Joseph. If we want to actually regain our position as fathers, as the head of the family, this is what we have to do. Thank you very much, and thank you for listening to me. God bless you.